gonna have to serve somebody.
Serve somebody.
Well, it may be the devil, and it may be the law, but you're gonna have to serve somebody.
Serve somebody.
You may be a rock and roll addict, prancing on the stage. You may have drugs at your command and women in a cage. You may be a businessman or high degree thief. They may call your doctor and they may call your chief, but you're gonna have to serve somebody.
Serve somebody.
Oh, you're gonna have to serve somebody.
Serve somebody.
Well, it may be the devil and it may be the Lord, but you're gonna have to serve somebody.
Serve somebody.
You may be a preacher with your spiritual pride. You may be a city councilman taking bribes on the side.
You may be... Eric Bibb, the son of the great Broadway performer, he's long since deceased, Leon Bibb, with Bob Dylan's You Gotta Serve Somebody. It's from his 2009 album, Sisters and Brothers. This is Leid Stories. I'm Eutrice Leid. And a couple of alerts I must give you as we start out the program. Our phones are misbehaving terribly, and we don't know whether they'll be up and running during the course of our program so that we can be telephonically connected. They're working on the issue now, and we shall see. This is another reason why when we endeavor to raise funds for PRN, it is for things like this. This is not our, quote, fault, unquote. It's just how things work or don't work from time to time without warning. They just, you know, blow up in our faces and we just have to make alternative plans on the fly. So we have some difficulties with our phones. They're being addressed at the moment. Let me just ask the studio, what's the state of affairs? They'll tell us whether we'll be able to get back up to the snuff during the course of our program. So tell us, what's the deal with the phones? If we are still going to hang on with the hope that they will go live, or whether we won't have phones for our program. We don't know. But it is important because these things illustrate how we take certain things for granted. We think that they will always be there. And that's not always the case. We are dealing with electronics and, you know, it's a hit or miss. Even though we like to think that we have everything under control, it's not under our control. That has to do with the control of the greater universe. Okay. So they tell me that right now the phones are working. So that's good. 888-874-4888. I need to get a message out to you. And that message is, those of you interested in registering for that special retreat that Gary is giving, that is in January 13th to 19th, there are a couple of slots still available. And I am urging you to put your health this year as a number one priority. And I'll give you a number to call. And Luann Panessi is on the end of that line. If she's not immediately available, she will take the time and make sure to make contact with you and to go through the particulars of the program, what it's about, what it would help you achieve. And it's about helping you become more involved and more in charge of your health, making health decisions. I can tell you, because I've been through it, it is remarkable what is achieved within just a matter of days. So her number is 903-881-7008. Don't wait at all. If you are interested, call right away. As I said, there are only a few slots available. And if you are interested and want to nab one of them, this is the time to do it. Don't wait. Don't hesitate. 903-881-7008. Okay, so what I wanted to talk about as we shift into pretending that all will be well throughout our program with our phones today. I wanted to talk about decisions, other decisions in our lives that we must make. We can't shirk our duty, and we can't avoid the inevitable. And the inevitable is, at some point, we have to grapple with certain political decisions that are ours to make. And it concerns the relationship between this government, such as it is, and us. What is the relationship here? Is there a relationship? If there is, what kind of relationship would you characterize it as being? And what, if anything, whether we are stuck with Trump, we're not stuck with Trump, what is supposed to be our arrangement? And we're talking now realistically. We're not talking theoretically. And ideals, you know, people, when these kinds of questions come up, people tend to get very idealistic about politics. I'm urging that we remain very grounded, very practical, and very concerned about the power equation in that relationship. Now, to be very honest, I've just given up about trying to find some kind of meaning about Donald Trump. I haven't found it to be any different from the way it started out to be, and what I noticed it to be from the very beginning. It has not changed, only perhaps in intensity. More and more, the president is showing signs of something is wrong, psychological instability. And I don't like the idea, personally, I don't like the idea of a government or any entity functioning with the certainty, with the knowledge that every single day of my life, my number one priority is to worry about them and what they're going to do next. I refuse to give them that power over me. And I know, because I see it, the country is in a psychological downturn, downspin. We don't know what the heck it is that is going on in Washington, D.C. We don't know how to correct it. In fact, we have every indication that we are not invited to correct it. We don't belong there. There are other people whose job it is to correct it, but we don't see the corrections. You know, we don't see it. So every day, we wake up worrying about what is the next disaster to befall us. We're not getting proactive answers about what is actually happening to cause a solution, to provoke a solution. And for me, I refuse to live this way. I refuse to have my life organized around some other system that has no intention of changing, that will not change, that is abusing its power, it's abusing the people, it's doing everything possible to indicate that it has no respect for the people. They're living in their own world, they're doing their own thing, they're running their own show. And our job, it seems, from their point of view, is to shut up and go along with it. I tuned out of that quite a while ago. And as I have urged you, listeners, the best thing that you should do at this time is to get your act together. Get your life together, get your system together, because inevitably it will be about your survival and our collective survival. There is madness going on, and there seems to be very little in the way of a defense for us. We have no defense. And it is time that we talk less about this, because it's just every day is a different version of the previous day. It is important, it is in fact imperative, that we fashion our own response, because in the end, it will come down to our survival, and everybody's got to have a survival plan. Now, I'm not trying to be an alarmist. I'm not trying to get people, you know, to run into the streets holding their heads and screaming. But I'm saying we actually have seen aspects of this before. And we need not wait to find out that we actually are in deep trouble. Just take for granted that we are in deep trouble. And therefore, the next set of questions would be, what are we going to do? The people in whom we have invested the power and authority to rectify the situation, according to how things are organized in Washington, D.C., they're not doing it. We'd be stupid to hold on or continue to hold on to the hope that they will experience some kind of epiphany and get down to work. We have no time. Some people may think we have time, but I'm saying from where I am, we don't have time for that. We have to knuckle down quickly, assess as best we can the situation as it exists and how it is likely to impact us and our communities, and figure out now some sort of strategy for survival. Because the odd thing is, with all of the shenanigans going on, these people have alternative ways to survive. They have backup plans. They have backup money. They have arrangements that they can put into play to tide them over. And if they had to choose between themselves and their personal agendas and us, who do you think they'll choose? Who do you think they will choose? So we have to get very serious about this business of putting our survival plans in motion. This is where it is. The government has become toxic, completely disregarding the well-being of the people. They have a very bizarre idea of what government is for, what it is they're there to do. It's a rogue government. Everybody is involved in some kind of crazy operation or another. It has to do with them personally and their, you know, their survival, as they define their survival. And their survival has never been defined as a shared survival. It's never been that way. We have to get clear. We have to stop believing in unicorns. The situation is very dire. And again, what really irritates me is that I've gotten up so many days so angry. I'm not accustomed to starting my day, you know, in a rotten mood. And it has a direct relationship to, as a person, what this government is doing. And also what it's not doing, all of which is having a negative impact, or potentially a negative impact, on me and my community. I resent that. I resent that this is what we have become as a nation, a gang of thieves who think of themselves first, and in some cases, who think of themselves only. We'd be crazy to ignore the signals that have been sent out to us. We'd be crazy. Here we are, we spend a lot of time talking about how things could be fixed and should be fixed. They're not bothering with us. It makes no impact on them at all. They're busy constructing not only survival for themselves, but for the generations to come, their grandchildren and great-grandchildren. That's what they're involved in. We would be crazy to set aside all of this time concerned and preaching the same message. We've got to fix this. This is an urgency. This is an emergency. We are in a state, not of crisis, but of meltdown. We're beyond crisis. We are in meltdown. And if you think that you could live this way and things will go right, okay, you're entitled to think that. But I say, if that's what you're thinking, you're just plain crazy. We are in meltdown. We need to understand that. The people who should be concerned about fixing things and fixing them immediately and regarding our situation as a crisis are using all of that energy to tell us they've got things in hand. They've got this under control. It's just a political spat. If you want to believe that, go right ahead. I'm not going to have a quarrel with you. But I'll tell you this. It won't be long before things go right down the toilet. And even so, when that happens, there will be this hierarchy of who gets help and who does not get help. So Get help for yourself now. Organize yourself now. Organize your life now. Prioritize now. And don't give any more time, any more precious time to these clowns. They could afford to dilly-dally. They have nice cushions to fall back on. But you and I don't. And even if we did, the fact is that we are not in charge of how this is going, how this country is being run. And we should be concerned because, like I said, this is no mere, you know, typical political spat. This is a major crisis. And you've got to reorganize your thinking and your actions accordingly. You are not supposed to do anything normal anymore. Not until we get definitive signals that the people in Washington and the people in our state capitals recognize that we are beyond crisis. We are beyond crisis. And I'm not being, you know, an alarmist here. I'm telling you what we see. We're looking at it and we're experiencing it, and they're telling us it is not as bad as you say. So get your health together, because you're going to need to be healthy. Take that task on, because it is going to be a necessary task in getting yourselves prepared for what's coming. All the indications are there. The country is about to just disintegrate. And now, while we still have a little chance, we still have a chance to fix things and turn things around. There is no indication of interest that that's what the people in Washington and the President of the United States are interested in doing. They're busy taking care of their personal fortunes. The hell with the rest of us. So that is what I wanted to talk about today. When you analyze the events of the last month, you see it's a sea change from the previous month. It was bad in the previous month. It got cryptic in the last month. And still we're running it as if, well, you know, it's politics. You know, people having differences of opinion. If you're still thinking that, you need to run quickly and sign up with a shrink. This is a serious time. It was serious before. But the level and intensity of the change that stares us right in the face, we haven't seen that for quite some time. And it's different from, let's say, the depression or the crash. It is a compounding issue. We have layer upon layer upon layer of things that we cannot ourselves, as the people, we can't fix it. We have no access to the throttle and brake of government here. We can't command this thing to stop and make it stop. We cannot demand a different course. We have no say. So we're watching ourselves disintegrate every single day. And still, we are persuaded to convince ourselves that what we're seeing is not what is happening. So we get involved in repeating the same scenarios over and over again, the Democrats versus the Republicans versus the Democrats, the pitiful state of affairs with independent politics, which still has no participation in the solution of a problem. And we are thinking, well, this is how it ought to be. This is an example, in fact, of a vigorous democracy. How's our democracy going on here? I am concerned that we have been falling too willingly for this sham, this game, which has now become perilous. We are letting people get away with things. We're not making the demands. We're not making it seem as if our demands are serious. We are not acting in accordance with the level of distress that we are experiencing every day. In fact, some of us are even rationalizing that the craziness will get even crazier because, well, that's the natural order of things, you know, when people are fighting and getting involved in political activity and so forth. No, it's not. It is not. I want to remind you of how calmly the reaction was and has been to entire cities being emptied before our eyes, systematically destroyed in a whole different way. Now they're telling us they're building these cities up. Where will people live? I saw an article of a young woman who is so totally disconnected, a black woman, writing one of those experiential pieces that the Times likes. You know, here's a chapter of life as a Negress. And she's writing about how she lives now in Harlem. Very yuppified, very converted, and very distanced from what it means to be black in this country and what it means to be black and living in Harlem. She's paying something like more than $2,000 a month in a renovated apartment. And she's obviously so thrilled because this now, instead of being a point of outrage, is a mark of distinction, a mark of achievement. Look at me. I'm a young black woman. I am black woman, hear me roar. I could afford to pay more than $2,000 a month for an apartment in Harlem. And I love it. I love it. I want more of this because it qualifies me. It qualifies me, and it affirms my progress in this world. We don't have to ask whether she eats well. We don't have to ask whether she is well. What's important to convey is that she has finally become an invader and proud of it. This is the kind of thing that is happening all over the country where there is such massive distortion of reality that you really have to take time and settle down in a quiet space and really try to understand what has happened and what continues to happen to us. So that was the topic that I wanted us to talk about today. Whether it is resonating with you or whether you're thinking, well, you know, it's part of life. We've been through this before. I've gotten over all of the cliches. They don't make sense. And they are an application of a level of mind bending that we haven't seen in a while. So let's take a gamble that the phones would not take off on us and that they'd stay around for a while. We'll take this break, and then your thoughts are very important, and we'll come back to your thoughts right after it.
But here, you might be someone's mistress, you might be someone's heir, got to serve somebody. You got to
serve somebody.
Might be the devil, and it may be the Lord. You're gonna have to serve somebody.
You're listening to Leid Stories on PRN.FM. I'm Eutrice Leid. The number is 888-874-4888. We're talking about the transformation. There's a definitive break here with President Trump. A definitive break. It's not about political theory. It is about the actuality of life changing dramatically, and we are encouraged not to pay attention to it. Susie from New York, you're on the air.
Hi, Eutrice.
Hello.
I just wanted to say, pretty much just make a comment that, first of all, I agree with everything you're saying. And what I really appreciate with what you're saying is that you're giving a solution. And I think the more we focus on the solution right now, really little by little, whatever it takes day by day, that I just think you've got the answer. I really do.
Well, I don't know what it is, but I know a piece of it. You know? I think we have to search, each of us, for the pieces of the solution that we get, we understand, and we can do. And we're reluctant to do that.
Yeah, I think that it's like, a lot of us in a certain vein have no idea how to do it. So I think it's determinant upon the people that have a little bit more of the getting it kind of thing and saying, well, I'm just going to start today with doing this. And hopefully, that's how I feel, hopefully that will get sort of an exponential kind of growth, and that, you know, it'll kind of be resolved from the inside, you know, or from the smaller community type things. And I honestly, that's what I'm trusting right now. And it's a little bit of actually what I'm seeing from some kind of backward look at how what I'm going to call not so rich people are dealing with stuff.
But from your own personal perspective, what directive, what personal directive are you giving to yourself as it relates to your survival? What are you ordering yourself to do?
What I'm ordering myself to do is to pay attention to nature and the health of nature. Because when it comes down to it, it's air, you know, so breath and water, and then ground. Hopefully sometime you can, you know, somehow you can grow some food. And that's how I look at it, is like, well, the thing I can do today is really make some plans for a spring garden because I must have that food. and really making sure that my spring water, wherever I can get it, hopefully, is clean and whatever it takes. I don't care the rules, you know. A lot of springs are starting to come under regulatory, you know, whatever, that starts costing money, and nobody pays to go to the spring and get their water. So it's like, you know, I'm kind of looking at that and saying, I don't care, whatever it takes. I'll give $10, I'll give $100. I don't care what it is. That's what I'm doing today. And I think okay. that little by little, that's what's going to happen. And it's on a lot, everybody's going to be different. You can't say
that's on a very good ground. That's very activist oriented. But I'm thinking yourself. Get selfish for a moment.
Mm-hmm.
What can you do, or what do you do to assure some control over your survival?
Okay, because I believe everything comes from the inside out. I think it's really making a commitment that my survival is my business right now, and that's going to be bottom line what's going to determine things. So that's kind of existential, you know. But on the physical is making my space really, you know, okay, airy-fairy sacred, and just saying my home or my garden or my whatever. That's how it looks like to me. It's like I'm trying to find a very self-sustaining home base right now.
Okay.
And it's on a lot of different levels, and I see it trickling out that way. But for me, it's like, you know, finding the most harmonious and sustainable housing I can find.
Well,
and then
you're dealing with it in your own way. But the more important thing is that you've elevated your consciousness about it, about your survival, and what you have to do to assure survival as you define it. Thanks, Susan, for starting us off today. Thank you so much. Maat from New York, you're on the air.
Yes, greetings to the beloved community and family. Yes, I'm listening to you, and I'm also looking forward to, because last year I was catching up on sleep, but I appreciate when you use this time to open up the lines and we can have a dialogue. Very important. Well, we have to be careful waking up angry or depressed, because one thing we know about that, it doesn't solve the problem. I think we must, as we're able to, keep up on what's happening. And I see, especially in the longer term, it being hopeful, because essentially this crook administration that's in the White House is actually giving us a roadmap to where we want to go from here. For example, the process of how the Democrats choose a candidate and super delegates, that's already starting to change. I think it's called the Convention of States, but when 11 states actually sign on to the resolution, which will basically nullify the electoral college. So, you know, we're living in what we think we live in, one person, one vote, you know, not to mention dealing with voter suppression, but 5 to 6 states. And it's amazing that you hear nobody talk about this, but 5 or 6 states have already signed on, so we only need 5 or 6 more, and at least we know, you know, a far right winger won't likely be able to occupy the White House.
If you don't mind me making the observation, I don't care about them. I don't care. What you're saying is an indication that the party might be waking up. We don't have the luxury of trying to figure out whether, in fact, that is true. I'm saying we have to be very selfish at this point. And our interests, not the party's interests, I don't care about the Democratic Party. I don't care about the Republican Party. I'm talking about the party of one. We'll go to a restaurant, that's it, party of one. That's what I'm talking about. We are way, way behind schedule for developing a system of survival. We're way behind that, and we have given that responsibility to other people and to other organizations and to other entities that do not have the interests of the people at heart. So I'm saying, I know it sounds very selfish, but that is exactly what we need. We need to be really selfish at this moment.
Well,
and
you
do. Look, do our own inventory. How well suited are we to our own survival?
I'm not disagreeing with you. What I'm doing is getting my individual house in order, and I've been a long time activist. So I'm also looking at strategies for how we can come together as a collective, because, of course, that is a big part of the problem. Let me just make this point because, the queue was so long, I didn't get in yesterday. I want to have some discussion, especially in light of first Steve Swartz, former Republican strategist, impeccable in his analysis of what's going on. And then Tim O'Brien, who is a biographer, tried to be sued by Trump about his true wealth, and Trump didn't succeed. They both said that on Trump's bedside table is a compendium of Hitler's speeches. And I can't help but wonder, because that's where we're going in terms of this fascism coming down, which we need to look at. I can't help but wonder that.
I'm saying get out of that mindset. The work we have to do is to get into our own heads.
Well, I am in my own head, but my last point is, in Mexico, with an agreement with the Mexican administration, they're putting in indelible ink numbers, not hospital plastic braces, but numbers. And in terms of the 7-year-old girl who died shortly after coming to the border, and the 15,000. So we have to also look at what's going on as we come up with our individual survival strategies and figure out especially how black people can come together as a collective. And that's my last point.
Thank you. We, at this time, the time has long gone for us to examine our priorities and to examine whether there's a link between our consciousness and our priorities. Or are they in sync, or are we, we're talking here, most people, if you talk to them, will not be able to tell you what their priorities are. They will not be able to do that. They're waiting for somebody to tell them what their priorities are. That's not the way it ought to be. And we have to get almost maniacal about it, because we have lost and continue to lose so much by not paying attention, by not being conscious of our priorities. And we will find, once we've done this kind of work, it's easy to decide whether you're going to waste time with this effort or that effort, or whether you're going to put your resources and your physical contribution to a whole different use. We are in meltdown, people. It's not a crisis anymore. I wish we were in crisis. That would be an improvement. But we're in meltdown. Our communities are shot. Our communities no longer belong to us. the infrastructure in our communities doesn't exist. Not for what we envision as being owed us as how communities ought to live. Nothing is in order. Nothing is in order. There's only chaos and all the negatives. We cannot allow that to happen anymore. If only for the sake of our sanity, we ought to have some kind of regulation of our communities and ourselves. And let's look to it as a national priority. But we've got to start somewhere. I'm not concerned anymore about Donald Trump. I already know. We can already surmise what he's likely to do for the next 25 years. Let's get serious. Patricia, you're on the air.
Thank you, Therese, and good afternoon to the PRN family.
Thank you.
I think everyone by now has seen the video of Jasmine Headley, the young lady who went to an HRA office last week to secure a daycare voucher for her child so that she could go to work. And what we saw was the behavior of what we have come to understand as the dehumanization of black and brown people at the hands of the police. That train of thinking has now transferred to people who, our people, who work in these agencies, because she was pummeled and her child was pummeled by black and brown people. And so I said all of that because in this order, this is my goal. Number one, to keep myself healthy. I eat well. I make certain I get enough sleep. I have disconnected from anyone who is negative in my immediate environment. So my number one goal is to keep myself as healthy as I can. And then my number two goal is to begin one by one by one to share with our people, and I use that as an example, about how we ourselves have lost our way and how we have internalized some of the negative imagery of ourselves, because only that could have allowed black men and women to treat her and her infant like that. And then lastly, I attend town hall meetings, not so much to challenge legislators, elected officials, which I do, but to be an example to black and brown people in the audience about what they should be doing and about how not to fear challenging them. You know, I share with people my experience with Kirsten Gillibrand. She had never had anyone ask her about a black agenda in public. And so she stuttered because nobody had ever asked her. So my plan is to keep myself healthy, share with my immediate people in my immediate environment where we need to be emotionally and politically, and then challenge others.
Well, in all social work parlance, that would be called an agent of change. You're an agent of change. You're leading by example. You're showing people how it works. And you're showing people what the results could be or what the results in fact are when we interact with a system, but from a position of strength. And the strength you have is knowledge of a system or the willingness to understand how a system works and how within that system you can bring some kind of force to bear to make things better. Most people witnessing the treatment that young lady got would shake their heads and say, isn't that terrible how she was treated? You have already gone a step further. And that is leading by example. That is what we need. That is the repair we need in our communities.
I don't know what else to do. That's all I can do.
That's, and I like the idea that you're working on your health, because that is an issue. Most people don't think it is, but it is. So thanks, Patricia. You're teaching us all the way, every step of the way. Thank you. Lincoln from Mount Vernon, what have you to say?
Hi, good day, you trees.
Hello.
Hello. You always make it a little tight, you know, in terms of staying straight to the point. So I'll start tight. I personally have always been working on self-mastery. Like, for example, I used to run the mile in between 3 minutes and 50 seconds to 4 minutes. I am in my 60s, and I'm trying to retrieve running a four-minute mile. I sometimes do sometimes do as many as 2,500 push-ups in a day. You know, I'm primarily a vegetarian. So I keep my physical self together, but I also pursue my spiritual life. Spiritual meaning that I keep aware of the fact that no matter what happens, we're all just passing through. And no matter whether the government is good or bad, whether we become millionaires or we are paupers, everything here is just for a time. So I always keep that in mind. I also, one of the things that grabs me, I never stop thinking about those sinkholes in Florida. And especially that one where this fellow was in his bedroom and the room, the floor just completely just collapsed and they were never able to retrieve him. And it always makes me think about life and its unpredictableness. I say, well, imagine his parents are such as they might have been thinking, oh, we have our nice dream house. And boom, it was just over just like that. And they had to evacuate that house and some of the surrounding ones. And, you know, it's like you see someone, you're on a trip to some place. You say, oh, I remember this black couple. They were Harvard graduates and, you know, they'd made it to Wall Street and they came out of the projects and they thought, oh wow, we made it. And so to celebrate their marriage, they went to the Bahamas and a shark bit off one of this guy's legs. And so all of his Harvard education and all of what they thought that they had achieved, you know, amounted to nothing. So in the midst of me thinking of politics, etc., I also think that the undergirding thing is really spiritual. Even though I speak a lot about politics, I do believe that mankind's true problem is a spiritual one. And so I'm trying to stay spiritually focused and also the physical, but I know that the physical is just a fleeting moment, you know. And I do believe that the biggest stage is the stage that we will encounter after we leave this physical world. So sometimes I get mad even at myself, like even when I come on your program and I am very angry. And I'm saying, why am I being angry? I'm just passing through here, you know. And, you know, good or bad, you know, everything is just for a moment.
I don't disagree with you at all about the spiritual component of a person's life. Because if it gives you strength and grounding and courage, if it arms you to deal with the difficulties that you will be experiencing in the course of the day or course of a month or a year, that's great. However, it does not relieve us from the crisis that we are in. And it is a very real crisis. It may have an entirely different form, but it, in fact, is what the spiritual warfare is all about, which is fighting against wrong, fighting against injustice, fighting against people making life unnecessarily unbearable for people just because they have the power to do so. with the certain knowledge that they will never be challenged, that people will never rise up, that people will never find the guts to say, this is not how I'm supposed to live. Now, your spiritual self is not separate from that. Your spiritual self should help you to gauge what is happening on a day-to-day basis and whether, either individually or as a group or as a community, we are being made to experience unnecessary suffering. People are doing wrong in government, and we have to correct it. But there we are. The music tells us we are out of time. Thanks so much for joining me today and for participating in the discussion. We come back to each other tomorrow. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Well, it might be the devil, might be the Lord. Gotta serve somebody. All right.
Stay tuned to PRN.FM for more empowering ideas from progressive voices. We're moving forward, and we hope you're coming with us.
My name is Renee with Vaccine Information Coalition, and our show is titled What...
I'm here. Do you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
All right, and where's your guest? Hello. Yep, I just got to I got to add them.
Okay, she was our guest the time before last. Dr. Kendra Becker.
Oh, she'll have to go over Skype as well.
Okay, she must have done it over Skype the last time.
Of course, I have no... Alright, let me, Oh, I see... You there? All right, you there?
I'm here.
All right, let me, I just saw Kay Becker, was it? All right, I'm trying to add someone to the call.
Okay.
How do we... Oh, that's out.